All right, in honor of the Penguins' first Stanley Cup win, we are going to watch One from the Heart, which, like it says here in the title, the story of the 1990-91 Pittsburgh Penguins. If you haven't never watched One from the Heart, it's probably one of the most just incredible series of any professional team winning a championship. It's just incredible. So if your kids are of age, it might be time to get them into it. This is I don't know. It's like, I don't know, something I've watched probably a million times, but I can never, like, I always want to watch it. It's just an incredible video for so many different reasons.
If we had everything in order, if we were on top of our game, we would have like a generic hit sound counter, because these videos just, they had all this stock audio that they would use. So every time a player would get hit, it would just make the same sound, like,
it was like Madden 95, like, yeah. Yep. It's incredible.
But we'll just get right into it here. I think this is the one with the KBL intro.
I think so too.
Yeah.
KBL Sports Network is proud to present One from the Heart. The story of the 1990-91
Pittsburgh. Like an intro guy. Hey, could you film this intro for us real quick? Like some guy in the studio.
The Stanley Cup has come to the city of Pittsburgh.
I still can't believe Paul Coffey was like a Penguin. Like,
this is like Trottier.
That was Trottier's like sixth cup.
Yeah. I think it was, yeah. A fairy tale that
came to life. Wow.
Like, Root Sports has made probably like 25,000 documentaries of this already, but
I know. A man who suddenly
found himself. I love the security guard's hat. Foolish
enough to believe. Like, he probably thought he was part of the team. Like,
did we ever note the announcer, like who the narrator's voice is?
No, but he and eventually rejoiced. Oh, wait a minute. I think I might have one time for the team, and because he did those late 80s, early 90s Bills Super Bowls.
Well, let's talk about this. Let's talk about that girl. Let's go back there real quick. Can we go back and see that hug again? I hate to do it early here, but watch this. Oh,
it's a big goal though. For the team and its fans. When?
It's like a Kelly Kapowski, like.
It's 30 years ago, so.
Yeah. Yeah, that lady's like 80, probably. 65? Like, collecting Social Security. That this championship season was one from the heart. The lines in this are just incredible. I think we did a breakdown a long, long time ago of this too.
Oh yeah, very,
you know,
very primitive breakdown of it.
The early years of the Penguins reads more like a soap opera than a success story. They came into the league very much like orphans. They were almost adopted by the Internal Revenue Service. They were saved from extinction by the Edward J. DeBartolo.
You know how DeBartolo made his money? Finally
raised to
mini malls. Like, he invented the mini mall or something? Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
While the team would be built around 66. Look at that flow. The search began for his supporting cast. Head coaches and GMs came and went. While important, it's a shame I hate Mark Recchi now as much as I do. Finally, in 89, the DeBartolo family handpicked. Were you with me that one time we saw him outside of Ribfest?
Into the promised land.
They chose Craig Patrick as their general manager. The very next year, he stunned the hockey community by luring Hall of Fame NHL coach Scotty Bowman to become his director of player development. Like, look at them, like, this TV, like.
Yeah.
Like, what's everything in that. He was really intent on watching that too. And be on the road and be out seeing
the world of hockey. I mean, when I say the world of hockey, I literally mean the world of hockey. Scotty's been everywhere this year. I mean, any place there's hockey being played, Scotty's been there.
Okay.
Patrick's stint behind the Pittsburgh bench last season convinced him to look for a heavyweight head coach.
I forgot to take Patrick. Highly
experienced, yeah, he... successful
Bob forgot Johnson. About that.
I could see that we needed someone of Bob's stature and caliber and experience to come in and lead this team, because just seeing what we had, we didn't have the proper mix of people that could do it themselves. They needed someone with a strong backbone who had those years and years and years of experiences, all kinds of experiences in coaching. He's been coaching close to 40 years, and nothing surprises Bob.
I want
to
get that sign.
Some hockey writers wondered if Patrick had surrounded himself with highly qualified successors, should he stumble.
Jesus.
But the quiet, soft-spoken man pressed on. Patrick would be.
Wonder who those hockey writers were.
Yeah, I know. Bob McKenzie. Star Mario Lemieux.
After successful back surgery, Lemieux contracted a rare bone infection that would sideline him.
I guess that's the no-contact jersey.
It's a great shirt. Collapse of the Pens never happened. Love that guy. The offensive burden was picked up by emerging. How did we never notice the primetime song in here?
And by yeah. Second year sensation Mark Recchi
and the gritty leader. I did not know that. John Cullen. It's the first time I've ever. Near the
top of the league. Imagine being the guy who wrote all those songs and just collects royalties.
Players were named to the NHL midseason All-Star.
See, this is what I don't like. The year before, the Penguins hosted the All-Star game, okay?
Yep.
So a bunch of the clips here are a year old because the Penguins are wearing their All-Star game patch right there.
Oh, yeah, that's... Yeah.
And...
They probably didn't have... They probably didn't have access to a lot of footage. Like, they probably just jobbed through.
For sure. But
yeah, it is. That's negligent, I feel. I never noticed that. It's tough for me to watch. Along with Paul Coffey.
Like, why are the fans going? Like, those are those sound effects?
Yeah.
There's no reason. Nobody even cared about the goal at the All-Star game.
They need to bring back those jerseys. Those All-Star jerseys were awesome.
I know. Scott Young. And in late January,
Mario returned. He scored a goal and an assist in his home debut against the Caps.
I think Lemieux is just... I say it all the time. It's just like... He's like one of those people you just watch... Like, you just watch him like when you're a kid. As soon as you know he's going to score when he's on the ice. Like, he's just excited.
That's how McDavid is right now.
Yeah. Round draft Double J. From Czechoslovakia. Jaromír Jágr kept the Pens in the hunt.
In goal, Tom Barrasso quietly returned to his all-star.
See, now I don't know, because this was Jágr's rookie year, right?
Right.
With personal tragedy lifted a quiet...
And he's wearing the All-Star patch.
Yeah, what? Maybe they give it to people.
I'm thinking it was the calendar year that you hosted it. So they hosted it in 1990. So then they wore it all through the year 1990. I don't know. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, because it'd be younger than kind of be.
I've been meaning to look into it for 25 years and I never have. Barrasso quietly
returned to his All-Star form. What small he is.
With personal tragedy lifted from his brow, he was now playing with a new purpose. But later,
didn't wear a neck guard.
The man
slid into a winter funk.
Rangers, fucking dirty.
12 points behind the New York Rangers, and their playoff hopes were dangling by a thread. In early March, with less than 24 hours remaining before the NHL trading deadline, and the Penguins drifting in mediocrity.
If you notice the byline on that, it's Tom McMillan. He was the
two articles.
Yeah, it's like he was basically the Post Gazette.
What is this? What does it say? Road. Road. What?
Where's that? Oh, I don't know.
Read me. Road.
Patrick show.
What the hell is he? What the hell is that?
Probably didn't have anybody to edit it because he's probably writing. And the Penguins
drifting in Road life.
Okay.
Patrick showed the hockey world who he was. He traded John Cullen, the team's leading scorer.
Like, how do you get Ron Francis for John Cullen?
Dave Molinari.
Oh, yeah. Oh, so he wrote for the... So I forgot the Pittsburgh Press, and then there was a strike, too, right?
Yeah. Zarly Zalapski to Hartford.
The players they got in return would change the very style of the Penguins... Here comes one of your sound effects, I think. Ulf Samuelsson was a Swedish linebacker. Yeah. His trademark was a thunderous check. Coming to Pittsburgh along with Ulf was a tough... I think I got it from Matt Jennings. Veteran center
Ron Francis. No, Madden didn't start until mid-90s, I think.
Yeah, you're right.
But regardless, each shift was his last. His specialty. He just holds the stick here.
The three highly skilled defensive style players were a signal of what was to come. As they had all season, Ryan Trottier and Joey Mullen continue to provide more. I love Joey Mullen's neck brace.
Yeah, me too.
Like was it like was his shirt not comfortable enough?
What exactly did that neck brace like? What what protection did it provide? I don't understand at all.
I don't either. Maybe he had like a Stanley Cup experience. He seems like one of those people that would be like bothered if like his shirt was like rubbing on his like neck or something. I don't know. I love Yuri Erdina. And to stabilize rookie teenager Yager. The trade and a healthy Mario Lemieux sparked the Penguins to a 9-2-1 tear in the month of March.
Incredibly, here comes that big Ranger game, I think.
Oh, yeah. I remember this is like an afternoon game against the Rangers in Madison Square Garden had a playoff atmosphere. Trailing New York by a single point in the standings, this was the Patrick Division showdown. Will he shoot it? He does score! Stevens got it! Rookie lead pass to Lemieux behind the defense, pulls it around behind him. Here he comes towards the net. Lemieux makes a little move, shoots and scores! It went in! What did that goalie do? But Lemieux has cashed in. The
Penguins have the lead. Went flying! Van Beesbrook, I think.
Lemieux was so good with that move. Here he comes towards the net. Lemieux makes a little
move, shoots and scores. It went in, pulled out by Hardy. Behind him, here he comes. But yeah, Lemieux talked about that. He said like his wingspan was so huge that he could move it left to right, and the goalie was forced to move with it. Then he would just go five hole. Like it was the easiest goal of all time.
So good. Lemieux behind the defense, pulls it around behind him. Here he comes towards the net. Lemieux makes a little move, shoots and scores. It went in,
pulled out by Hardy. But Lemieux has cashed in. The Penguins have the lead, 2-1. That's Richter. Here's a play though to Stevens, looking for the hat trick. Israel shot, save, a rebound. Score, Lemieux, with 3 seconds left. And the Penguins do get a power play goal, and they lead 4-2. The Pens clobbered the fading Rangers and never looked back. Then, on March 21st, at home, Stevens scored in overtime to beat the
Rangers.
I remember this goal, too. How did who was that? Van Helman? How did he even see that that was in from where he was at?
There's no video review either. The Rangers again. Lang right away.
Finally, the hockey gods seemed to be smiling on Pittsburgh. I love how everything relied on this, like, that was when we started to make retired, like, steel worker running the goal light. Like the goal judge. I know that
once we, yeah, but yeah, like what happens if he like wasn't able to like? Game, we had a good shot to win the division, and if he didn't like didn't come to work that day, probably did it for free. 1 week later, the Pens face the Detroit Red Wings and the
chance to make history. Yeah, no video replay. It just like a lot of the times they said was the goal light on, then it was a goal. Like
yeah.
Pittsburgh Penguins won the game and clinched their first ever hat trick.
Who's that menacing guy in the? Do you see that? Were you riding that menacing guy on the bench? Ever. In the white shirt.
The big huge dude? Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, who is that guy? Massive human being. It's one for the money, two for the show. But we get red and I go cat go. Part of the girl's excitement is Mike 35 Price, right now. The radio and TV voice.
No, that means she was five, and that that would mean she's 5 years old right here.
She's probably, yeah, I mean, she's like, well, she's like probably nine, maybe.
Yeah, we won't. I don't want to get too deep into analysis.
Yeah.
But like, is Mike Lang, anyway, the radio and she's probably 40. Voice of the Penguin since 1974. His colorful, offbeat expressions have made him a cult figure among Pens fans.
Absolutely.
These three guys are going nuts. No one else is even doing anything.
Nice polo to wear to a game.
Yeah.
Like you pointed out one of the other, like nobody wore jerseys to games. Except for that guy in front.
Yeah. So
he probably before.
That lady right there is running the show, but that's it.
Yeah, there's like 12 people in there. Like nobody. All these old people in there. Baggy. Have been waiting a long time for a real shot at the Stanley Cup. The anticipation began to build as the 19. Didn't the Capitals just like come out and just, like destroy them this game?
Devils first round.
Devils, right? The fourth place Patrick Division Devils entered the Civic Arena as the series underdog, but their regular season record went out the window early as they smothered the Penguins' offense and dished out some brutal kicks.
Jesus.
Their big physical game was working, and the Devils stunned the Pens in game one and stole the home ice advantage. Game two saw New Jersey pounding away again. Stevens' nose was broken. Recchi took stitches in the
Jesus.
God.
Still, the Pens fought back.
Is this Yager OT?
Yeah.
Tied 4-4 in overtime.
The goal.
The Penguins were desperate. It was here that their teenage sensation took center stage.
So good.
18 years old, I think.
Yeah. Yep. Like on the third line.
But the Devils, behind sizzling goaltending by Terreri, won two of the next three. And
so we're going to see the save, too.
Yeah, it's coming up right here.
The Pens were only one loss away from elimination. The news turned even worse as Tom Barrasso was scratched for game six. With
House of Fear. I've never even heard that phrase. I don't know what they came up. I don't know.
Frank Pietrangelo, who had appeared in only two games in the last.
Pens are like, we're fucked.
Yeah, imagine that, like you're a goalie like was taking a beating.
But he pumped in two critical first period scores.
Here comes your goal celebration.
This is a great. This is great. Yeah, this is an iconic celebration.
Then, one of the most dramatic moments in the playoffs unfolded. Pietrangelo faced the Devils' Peter Stastny right on his doorstep. Tisov shoots it, deflected right in. Pietrangelo save rebound. Stastny stopped by Pietrangelo. I don't believe that save. Neither does Peter Stastny. He can't believe the save that Pietrangelo just made on him.
That guy in the background still thinks it went in.
Peter Stastny should get Ben and the stun picks. I wonder. Yeah. We should probably look in Getty to see if there's stun picks from that.
I still, when I saw Stastny moving into the puck there, I turned the other way because I know it's a goal.
What are you, Stastny? Like, just bury it, dude.
Tough situation in Jersey. We had to win the game. Facing.
I love these interviews of Lemieux. Does he have glasses on? No, he doesn't.
Yeah, that's the next one. That's the 92. In the playoffs for us. Huge glasses. The stop was so
outrageous that it. That's the only time he's ever worn glasses, too. That's just a funny thing about it.
Samuelson fueled the Pens' fire with some hard
sound effects.
Yeah, oh yeah. Face defense.
Punches guys. Scored on
the way to a fourth. Punch them in the face. And the Pens
forced hard. Imagine how bad this hurts.
Hard nose in your face defense can like breaks his nose.
Like interference.
Yager and Francis scored on the way to a 4-3 win, and the Pens forced. Oh, here we go. This is one of the better segues. Back in Pittsburgh. They zoom in on that church up near
Hotel. Yeah. Many prayed for divine intervention against the Devils for Game 7. At the like, whoever made that was probably like the editor of the video was like, this is going to be it.
Yeah. Again, it came in the unlikely form of Frank Pietrangelo, as well as the courageous early return from an eye injury of Paul Coffey.
The Coffey's like, I'm playing. Miracles
yeah. Had not ended. And then, like, the next series, he breaks his jaw.
It's one of the only times the Penguins won a Game 7 on home ice.
Honestly, yeah. The went on to Tampa Bay a couple years ago.
Well, we go back. Can we look at that guy in the ponytail real quick? This is a great fist pump here in the audience. Watch this guy here. The backup goaltender went on to stone the Devils.
Yes. The backup goaltender went on to stone the Devils.
Is that a? The backup goaltender went. Are those little penguins on her shirt? Devils,
I think so. The backup goaltender went on to stone the Devils, shutting them out in a lopsided 4-0 victory. Bruce Driver. He is a hot goaltender, red hot. They're just not going to beat him. He was aided by two marvelous goals by Yuri Perdina. The speed and aggressiveness of the Pens was simply too much for the stubborn Devils. And the Pens.
How do you let that through there?
Yeah, I don't know. To advance to the second round of the playoffs. Look at all the guys in suits.
Yeah.
Beer probably costs like $1. Wait, so this is the first win in Game 7 in history, too, you said?
Yeah. I think Yager tries to kiss that guy right there at the end. Watch Yager.
Yeah, that was weird. At no time during the season was the this coat right here. Coach Bob best coat.
Yeah. I remember looking for it 5 or 6 years ago on eBay. The media demands grow. Then I realized I'd never wear it. Expectations soar. It is vital that the most uncomfortable jackets of all time.
Yeah, it had to be. Couple more, guys. Couple more. Wolfskin's pretty good. Huh? It's pants, too. Very. What's that? It's like, is he painting after the like? Start watching the game tonight. Go to a good Western. Go to the cable and find a good Western. Yeah, every picture of Mary Lemieux, I've never seen him in glasses other than like. That's right, a ring fighter. See, this is a guy played hard last night. He played hard. Sorry.
Yeah, it's unnecessary.
Yeah, this is weird. I feel really. We're only as good as our last game, guys. What do you think? What do you think the cameraman's thinking here? Like, all right, like,
let's go do some interviews in your office, sir. That he did, I don't think any
other coach was able to do was teach us defense. And I thought that Bob, when he came,
Joey Mullins, like,
he's living and dying with that brace. But, even though you lose by 4 or 5
goals, I still think you can win. Did he have a history of a neck?
I don't know. That type of coach that
brought a lot of confidence. Great shirt here, by the way. We had, and he's a great
hockey coach all around. The confident Johnson and his crew. They get teabagged in this first game.
Yeah, bad. Capital squad in the Patrick Division Finals.
The Caps had defeated the Rangers in six games in their first round matchup. And from the drop of the puck, the playoff Capitals appeared.
You're not instilling any fear in the person you're yelling at.
The Pens were sluggish and again lost the opening game of the series.
No celebration by LL Rises. He's just like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
But Dale Hunter.
That was Dale Hunter.
And Lemieux took charge.
Another overtime game, isn't it?
Game two, yeah.
They're just like bouncing around here. Dude, what?
Why would he? That was a clean hit. Like, it just seems like it's scripted. Like, hey, Cicerelli hit him real hard here, so Penguins go on the power play. Like, it was just... Ari must have just been rattling him mentally. What a hit.
Yeah, followed his check. Can't touch Gino. Can't touch him.
Pittsburgh's power play started to click, and the Pens began
just don't... Never mind. Never mind. A lot of rumors around that early 90s Caps team.
Yeah. Cheap goal. The workhorses. Mark Recchi scored so many big goals.
Yeah. Phil Borg. Gordy Roberts. Bob Airy. Oh, he was in Cicerelli's head.
Teamed with veterans Larry Murphy and Peter Taglianetti.
Oh, here comes that big time goal.
Gillen came oh yeah, that's right.
Game two with a goal late in the third period to tie the game.
Maybe Gillen. Is he like a doctor now or something?
Then Kevin Stevens took control in the
overtime. Nice shirt by that guy. Yeah, this was true. I think Paul Coffey gets hit in the face here. He gets so mad about it.
Yeah, Murphy, just un.
He's like, fuck.
The electrifying score would be the first of three consecutive game winners for Stevens. Two of them on the road.
That's a staple power forward move.
The Pens eliminated the Caps.
The series is over quick.
Styles. They never adapted to what we were doing. Most of their offense came off of dumping the puck in, working to get it back in their zone. When they kept dumping the puck in, I would
what was that?
Dump it out.
And, my zone, I don't know.
Did it say ball sack? What did it say?
That's a one sack Siri listening into my conversation. Very weird, very bizarre. It's never happened before.
Scores, if you give them the opportunities like we had, those guys aren't going to miss very often.
But the four games to one victory.
Seems like you really had to like make it all about Tom Barrasso.
I know.
Did not come without a price. Paul Coffey was lost with a fractured jaw.
Oh God.
Alf Samuelson suffered a broken hand.
Forgot about that.
Probably shouldn't have punched that guy in the face.
Shouldn't have punched him right.
Mark Recchi continued to shine.
This is like the most bizarre sequence in any
scoring leader.
Yeah.
Like, with 20 points.
He's driving through the strip district right now, probably.
Recchi had come like you're like from those who said like pro too small to
play. Let's follow him to his townhouse in Bridgeville.
Like the way, it doesn't even have a paved driveway.
He gets the mail here too.
You know, I was always smaller than everybody, so I wanted to prove that I could play no matter what.
Like, it just shows like the difference in like pro athletes now. Like, you're just driving like a Cutlass. Like, you have air conditioning.
Help push this Pens team farther than any squad in club history. The Wales Conference Championship against
Trottier, like knew everybody. He's just like,
yeah. Bruins.
Oh God! I wish if there's any series that I wish I could like be have a time machine to go back, it would be this one, just so I could revel in.
50 tries.
God.
The hallowed garden was a stone's throw from where the Penguins Barrasso, Bork, Stevens, Taglianetti,
I remember.
Paul Stanton were
he says here that like the Stanley Cup, you know, everybody was leaving the Penguins for dead and stuff. I remember hung from the ceiling like you know, going back and looking at some articles, like nobody picked the Penguins to beat the Bruins. Nobody. Like before the series, like forget the 2-0 deficit. Like,
oh yeah, you could, yeah, you can't, because you can't say anything bad about Boston ever. So,
Jesus Christ. I don't know if we're going to survive this series here. Like, God.
God, like CTE and Cam Neely. It's pass. It's like a cage match. The first two games turned into an alley fight. Devastated. This is like my first devastating loss I remember as a fan. The game two overtime. It was one of the shakiest games of the playoffs for the Pens. Game two. All these stupid Boston people. Look at that guy. Go back real quick. This is every Boston Bruin fan. Like right underneath the Boston flag. Look at this guy's face. Look at that guy. Yeah. The thumbs up guy. That's Boston. That's Boston. Once again,
Stevens, Lemieux, except he's carried the offensive load. On the defensive side, Ulf Samuelson was assigned to Boston tough guy. Assigned to him.
This was the interference every single play. Samuelson's relentless. What a job by Ulf Samuelson.
Yeah. All-star was beginning to take Jesus. Neely's patience was wearing
thin. How mad Cam Neely is. Lemieux gave the Pens their only lead of the night. I thought they lost this game.
Yeah, they tied up on a two-man advantage here.
Oh, that's right. With less than 5 minutes to play, referee Merrowelli shocked even the Boston crowd when he awarded the Bruins a two-man advantage. Playing to the crowd.
They just randomly picked what penalties they were going to call. Like, it's just... Boston. When he awarded, if you watch,
doesn't die. Shocked even the Boston crowd when he awarded the Bruins a two-man. Like we saw, like four things just 2 seconds ago. Like there's clear penalties. The gift provided Boston bad penalty, with a golden though. Opportunity, which they quickly cashed in. Just pass. Despite outplaying and outshooting the Bruins for three periods, the Pens would come up empty. Is it this right here? I remember this. I was like in tears.
The Pens were now in the deepest hole of the 91 playoffs. I think the team developed a lot of strength from that and a real attitude of, hey.
Is Tom Barrasso around anymore? Is anybody talking to him? Like,
I don't know. He's I don't know what it was. I think he's the coach, goalie coach for somebody.
We had our normal talk, like we're up 2-0. The guys at the plane joking and you know, having a couple of beers and just relaxing, and there was no tension at all. And Kevin Stevens came out in the Boston papers and said, you know, and to all of us, we're gonna win four straight. And it was just, you know, we knew we deserved that second game.
It's a hockey night in Pittsburgh tonight from the Civic Arena. It's game three of the Wales Conference Finals between the Penguins and the Boston Bruins.
In game three, the Pens were back with the folks that loved them the most. They showered their fans with a barrage of offense.
Indy Moe was
what did Ulf Samuelson sharpen his ear? It's just
he's just probably like, fuck off. I've never seen a player be in an entire team's head like Ulf Samuelson.
It's a real good point.
Maybe since Gary Roberts in 2009, that Senators game. I remember that goal.
Samuelson and Neely continued their own on-ice battle.
Well, that was the hit. Did they not
adjust that? Yeah.
Continued to clear a path for Barroso. Did they whitewash it in this?
No, they talk about it, I think. Or actually, probably, yeah, they probably don't.
They have to, because I think they show Melberry going nuts, if I remember.
Game 4 was a mirror image of Game 3.
It's a gloveling on the ice.
The Pens dominated from start to finish, and Kevin Stevens' prophecy of a Penguin series victory began to look like more than just smoke. The Pens cruised to another 4-1 win, and suddenly, the series was tied at 2 games apiece, and the momentum had clearly switched.
You gotta appreciate that woman.
Yeah,
like, going to the big game, but she wants Lang. And the momentum
had switched. I never understood people that did that, but I mean, I can respect it.
Game 5 is she's dead. The heartbreaker
in the series. This yeah, one was back easily. In the garden, and it was billed as the game.
Tom Barrasso absolutely mesmerized his hometown as he stole the spotlight in a near-flawless performance.
His That's clear.
In clearing the puck, and his aggressiveness taking away the angles had stifled the Bruins.
Taking away the angles.
34 shots as his offense stepped into...
Oh, they broke Andy Moog this game.
Yeah.
Ray Bourque's like always a step behind Lemieux.
The Bruins were tired as the Pens ravaged goalies Moog and Lemelin in a 7-2 shocker.
Big controversy coming up. Game 6.
Goal late in the game was
Game 6 at home. My mom, I remember she like organized some big watch party at the sports garden down in Station Square for Game 6.
Wow.
Like, 4 local couples were going to go down and watch the game. And like, my dad didn't want to go. Like, he wanted to watch the big game at home, but he had to go. So, my grandmother had to come over and watch us. I had to come over to my house and watch us, and I watched the game with her, Game 6. Showed everybody that it didn't matter whether he got the fight and the feed up or whatever. My dad still brings it up. Shift in, shift out. Like, he didn't want to be at the sports garden. Cam Neely off his game,
and that gave us a chance to imagine to go
on and, but and play the rest of the ball. It's one of his favorite stories, though, because the sports garden had some rule that, you know, if you weren't eating food, you could go sit at the bar, but the tables were for, you know, people eating. So they had a nice table set up. They had like 8 people. So like, as the game was going on, my dad said, like, they just ordered nachos, and every time the woman would come around, he would just reach and, like, eat a nacho. So they couldn't kick him out. Yeah. But that's all about tipping the waitress well if you're going to be there all game.
Yeah. Moving into the Stanley Cup Finals for the first time ever. When they took to the ice for Game 6, 24 years of wait a second. Was the Neely hit 92 then?
No, it was 91. They just whitewashed it, like you said.
Wow, they can't even talk about it. That's incredible. Turned that's incredible. A magnificent shower of affection. Melon Reed out of game is insane.
The classy Bruins quieted the sold out Civic Arena with 2 second period scores.
You used that in the recap several hundred times. Many recaps. But this was a different Penguins team. Bobby Ergie hit everything that moved. How bad was Andy Moe? What was he doing on that? Pittsburgh and Boston
swapped third period scores. There's your Mark Recchi.
Yeah, Recchi. One off of one leg, too, right? Yeah. Yep. Great shot.
To give you an idea, like, this Gordie Roberts goal people don't talk about, it gave him the lead with, like, 8 minutes to go, and then the Bruins tied it. But, like, you can see the fans freak out. Like, this was the goal.
Yeah.
Like, watch the fan. Like, people are, like, crawling over each other and, like,
yeah,
going nuts in that shot.
it's like first time, you know, you're thinking like, oh my god, like big cup fever, like that guy probably just like is totally shocked. Great line coming up right here, Lang, right?
All business.
Lady's gonna cry.
All business.
Ling had so many incredible calls, but the last Stanley Cup call was so bad. I wonder if he regrets it.
Yeah, it's unforgettable.
It's really just, it still haunts me to this day. Didn't touch the Whales trophy. Oh, no, they did. They did touch it.
The hysteria of the Penguins' dream season had touched every corner of the city.
I love this. This is...
That sign is still there.
Yeah.
Still using dot matrix technology.
That's a bizarre. These are the best. These are the best.
Here comes Michael Keaton.
Batman. Guy really did look like Elvis. Yeah. To his credit.
He was probably just doing women all the time after these big games.
I'm the guy that plays Elvis at the Penguin game. Who would have the Penguins? Who would they have played?
Oilers.
Minnesota North Stars. The North Stars had barely made it to the playoffs with a regular season record well below 500. But they shocked the number one and number two regular season finishers in the first two rounds.
I think he says it here.
And when they dismantled the defending Stanley Cup champion Oilers, they became the clear favorites to take the cup.
Was Gretzky already in L.A.?
Yeah.
North Stars checked the Pens into submission in game one. Their game was
that cup before this year was Messier finally, like, Steve Younging it, winning it on his own.
They were willing to take some
penalties as their penalty killing was. How about a penalty here? Jesus.
Yeah, Carey Fraser looking at the player.
Yager spits at him.
He really did.
I don't think it's the right move after to spit at the referee.
Not the carry, right? Yeah.
Samuelson's early goal gave the Pens a hollow lead. The Stars kept coming back and finally took game one, 5-4.
Bad goal by Brad.
Oh,
we didn't play well. We're kind of out of it again, maybe first game. So it seems like we didn't really have the intensity. And, you know, we knew we were going to take a beat, and they were a big team. But after that, we started to play well after that first game. And, it was just one of those series where after we lost that first game, we said we're not going to lose, you know, the next game.
Fans wondered if losing game one in each series was a positive pattern. Maybe so, as Paul Coffey returned unexpectedly.
Paul Coffey was like made of like from a
broken jaw. Carbon fiber.
Broken jaw.
His return was an emotional lift for the club, and they came out of the gate in game
two. I was going to go new goal too, I think.
With the Pens shorthanded in the first period.
If you want, I think the whole game two is on YouTube. Like the first time Paul Coffey gets the puck, like people lose their minds because he had been out for, you know, a couple rounds. And then in this game two, when he touches the puck and like sits behind the net for a second, like people lost their minds.
That's pass.
Meanwhile, at the other end of the ice, Barrasso was red hot.
Stars goalie Casey had stolen the headlines, but Barrasso was quietly shutting down Minnesota's big guns. Late in the second period, Mario brought a sold-out Civic Arena to its feet with perhaps the most spectacular goal of the playoffs.
Connor McDavid-esque.
That guy's stomach hanging out by the glass always bothers me. Always, like, it's like the first thing I look at. I don't know why. Always has bothered me for a number of years. Watch it. Can never just, like, get a
shirt.
Yeah,
that's a good point.
Come on. Shame. Nice hug in the crowd. It's like, you're John Casey. They're like, just stand there. Don't.
Yeah, I don't know. He tried to be a hero.
Why would you go for a poke? Like, you're not on defense. Like, what are you doing? Like, you've had to watch tape. You know who Mario Lemieux is. Like, really dumb decision.
Mario's goal lifted the Pens to a 4-1 victory, and even the series at one game apiece. Game 3 was in Bloomington, Minnesota, and in a building the North Stars own. They had lost only 2 games in the Met Center since late January.
Tough the place to play.
Yeah.
The fans were quite intimidating. If that wasn't enough adversity.
Shows you like Mike Lang was in their head.
Yeah, didn't Elvis die? And the fans were quite they were sick of it. Welcome to the jungle.
Yeah, it's...
Mario was a late scratch for the game as he suffered severe back spasms just before the contest.
I remember growing up and I'd hear back spasms with Lemieux. I'm like, yeah, whatever. And then, like, I think last year I had back spasms.
What is this guy writing on? You see that?
That's the computer to... I think that's the computer to type stuff into the Jumbotron.
Okay. Yeah, you're right, though. Back spasms, you're right.
I had him last year. I don't know how you could go play like a professional sport. And MacGyver's in the box.
Yeah. Look at that chandelier, like show me how rich you are. Yeah. Like, okay. Their premature burial.
And when Mario took the ice to start, oh God.
It was a surly Penguins team that rattled the so pissed behind John Casey. John Casey, did he want to be in the series?
I really don't think so.
Really underprepared. I think the Crier Wind is Watch is one of my favorite. It's a great call.
When scored in the second, it appeared to be a 4-1 Penguins runaway, but the Pens took a...
Is this the penalty kill game?
Yeah, Troy Loney hits Mark Tenorti in the face. And it used to be a 5-minute major. It wasn't no double minor nonsense. Like, if you drew blood, it was 5 minutes.
Yeah.
I think you were kicked out of the game, too.
Troy Loney's accidental high stick drew a 5-minute major penalty.
Dive.
The North Stars power play had set a record for the most goals in a playoff season. The noise was deafening.
5 minutes.
It was here, amidst 16,000 screaming Met Center fanatics.
That's a great call.
The Penguins discovered who they were.
Like...
The one guy was—he was so confident that something good was going to happen.
Yeah.
And challenged the North Stars. Time and again, the play broke down in the neutral zone. Minnesota was being smothered by, of all things,
defense. It was a beautiful collective harmony of movement. It was the dance of champions.
He just lays it on thick.
Minnesota
great.
Had not managed a single shot on goal. And when a frustrated John Casey tripped Phil Bork, the power play was over.
Honestly, though, so like watching this with fresh eyes, I haven't watched this for in years. John Casey's was, if it wasn't for John Casey, Penguins don't win this cup.
Yeah,
he was just a head case.
he must have been, I don't know if he was on something during the game. Like, he was, just didn't really seem interested in.
There's no reason to trip Phil Bork right there.
No, I mean, you're on a 5-minute power play. Every goal he gave up was like extremely strange.
Then they teabag him here again. He scored like 4 goals right away. Was
overwhelmed by the excitement of a real live Stanley Cup chase. Nice sign. I watched it build itself up. You know, I seen the blue and white go to the black and gold, and here we are now. This is where we belong. I've been offered a hell of a lot of money for my tickets, and I won't give them up for anything because it just means so much for me to be here. This is Lucky Mario. He will send Minnesota back to its cold tundra. I can't. I just can't. It was as if the North Star that shot always reminded me of like Princess Diana. Doug Hayes is just like. People were locked in.
Yeah. I mean, just think about it. It's late May. Everyone's wearing shorts to the game. Sun's still shining when you walk in.
Second goal of the night. It was 4-0.
Watch Lemieux. Lemieux knows Recky's open, so he just shoves it to him.
It's a great goal. Like, John Casey just like maybe he must have got like really tired or something.
I think so too. The Pens' explosive offense clearly had the North Stars. Dude, she's pumped.
But at the start of the second period. It was the Brasso's like who were surprised. A diva.
Yeah, he's enigmatic. In goal. Tom Brasso was injured. They don't even mention what happened. He was just like, he's hurt.
Minnesota made a switch as well. Well, thank God. Casey for Hayward. But the North Stars. I love how he never addresses the goalie, the other team's goalie, by their full name.
No, yeah. Through the third
period. It's always like. It was 5-3, Pittsburgh. But then Gagne scored for Minnesota to close within one goal at 5-4.
It would be another blatant goaltender interference here coming up. Peter
Angelo made several
stunning saves. I don't understand how this goal counts at all. And Troy
Loney's goal with less than 2 minutes remaining. I'd be so mad if I was a North Stars fan.
How's that count? Like he crawls out of the net with his arms up, and Fraser's like, it's a goal.
We were happy winning it, but with the end result and everything, we just weren't satisfied. We just said we got.
Seems like also it seems like every goal, players are just chasing Carey Fraser around. Like you can see him in the background, everyone's like chasing him.
He like looks at it. Like,
right after game 5, we thought we have to win game 6.
He didn't even seem to like make a declaration. He just like skated. He's like, yeah, it's a goal.
What a tough job.
Yeah.
Like, especially late 80s, early 90s, there was a chance you were going to get stabbed with a broken beer bottle walking to your Buick LeSabre after the game.
We got in trouble the last couple of games before that game 4 and 5, where we got a big lead and then sat on it. But for us, it was just trying.
This is my favorite. This is my favorite. This transition.
Oh, and they're on the plane.
Oh yeah, I forgot they're on the plane. It's right. It's after.
Oh
the
yeah,
plane
when they're
scene.
Walking down the tunnel. Yeah.
I forgot about the plane thing though.
If
you could point your finger at one man most
you think
leading this team narrator would have to be big number 66. I think they just did this as filler because they're like, oh shit, we have to make this an hour.
Yeah.
It has been said that genius needs a stage.
Showcase
for the unmatched skills.
Somebody has that sign in their basement right now.
Yeah, you know, you wonder. Me too.
Lemieux shook off the effects of months of rehabilitation and re-injury to lead the team in playoff scoring. He was being shadowed by the NHL's best defensive forwards every night. When even he thought he had nothing left, he would appear at the other end, stealing the puck from a two-on-one.
Very underrated defensive player.
Just by default, like he could gain so much ground.
Mario's a goal scorer, and he always
and he never got his just due of having the players around him to be a winner. But he still showed up every night and did what he was supposed to do, and finally the pieces of the puzzle started to come together.
If you look at our team, you have to start with Mario. I mean, he's our leader, and in my opinion, the best hockey player in the world. I think he showed that through the playoffs, and he showed the type of character he has to be able to come and to lead this team after all the adversity that he's gone through.
The miracle. I want to see like a Tom Barrasso, like modern day Tom Barrasso.
I think I saw a quote from him last year, maybe.
I'd like to welcome you all on board our US Air Penguins charter.
US Air.
Nice. What a.
Look at that.
Amazing, like, palette of food.
And confident Penn's team that hit no the beards the last time this season.
No.
The whole playoff beard thing wasn't a thing yet.
Game in 52 days. The team appeared to be calm and focused as
there's your glasses.
I still understand his actuation of the best. This makes sense. Best, this, there you go.
This impossible season came to Saturday, May 25th in Bloomington, Minnesota. Was the Pittsburgh Penguins' appointment with destiny.
Better not lose, then.
The Met Center was a frenzy. There was a sense of desperation in the air. From the opening moments, Minnesota's frantic physical game backfired.
I love how they call this a penalty. Bad.
Against the Stars.
Don Koharski.
Seconds into the game would cost them.
But at the same time, I think it's a legit penalty. Like 9 seconds in, they knew Barrasso was injured, and he just like tries to take out his leg.
That's true.
Yeah,
that's a good point. You're
like,
right.
Watch Broughton.
Minnesota's frantic physical game. Yeah, can't
do that.
An interference call against the Stars just 9 seconds into the game would cost them.
This is another one of those games I know everything about because it was on that Greatest Games DVD.
A screen with less than 2 minutes gone staggered the North Stars. The next blow by Mario Lemieux.
This is great.
May have been the knockout punch.
This celebration here, his hand.
Yes. That was a shorthanded goal. They were killing like 3 penalties in a row, basically.
That was a big goal at the time. It was a 4-on-3. We were shorthanded. Murphy made a great play.
Like, right before this sequence, Lemieux was already out for like a minute on the PK, and like the entire unit changed. But then you just see Lemieux just like wave off the change, like he doesn't want to come off. And then he just the next play, he just grabs us and scores.
I always wish that I could see the Penguins bench. Like, there was a video camera. Like I'd love to see the reaction to this.
Minnesota was reeling, and the Penguins could smell blood.
Taganetti stops, looking. He might as well shoot it. Goes to Mullet, shoots it. Stop made. Rebound. Pick up to Mullet. He shoots and scores! And the Penguins lead 3-0.
I think those previous two games, the Penguins jumped out big, and then the North Stars were able to come back.
What followed was an
awesome display. Even on this fourth goal, there people were still holding out hope. But, like, they were still like, okay, they'll come back. And then this next goal, Ron Francis, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, slap shot. This was vintage.
This is just on the breakaway. But that was it.
There wasn't any other goalies in the NHL that could have been better than the North. Like, my God. Jim Pack.
I sat back on the bench, and on the other side of me was Mark Recchi, and like he gave me a big hug and stuff and said, Bubs, we did it, you know? And it was that I finally could just kind of go like that, you know, and realize that we won it. And then I couldn't wait for the clock to tick down.
And then as the clock just started ticking off in the third, you know, the guys were yelling 16 minutes left, 15 minutes left, 14, all the way down.
And it was so exhilarating to get down to where it was 8 minutes left in the game, 7 minutes left in the game, where you could say, let's just enjoy it a little bit.
When it was done, they had crushed the North Stars 8-0.
They brought Casey back in.
Shutout may have been Tom Barrasso's most shining moment. Mario Lemieux would be awarded the Conn
Smythe think about that.
Trophy. As the most valuable player
like,
in the playoffs.
You were thoroughly beaten to the point where they had to make another goaltending change and bring back in the first guy.
Mario Lemieux was like, I remember. I don't know what I was reading, or I don't know if my dad told me about it. Like, Lemieux was, like, getting, like, a lot of criticism from, like, you know, the typical Canadian media. Like, people, like, were saying, like, oh, you can't win the big one. Like,
well, he was playing with, like, garden hoses for 5 years. Like, what do you expect?
You know how the Canadian, they got mad. Like, but yeah, there was, like, a big smear campaign against him, and then after this it was like it. Go for
it, Mario, go for it. Yeah, you can hear in Lang's voice, like,
yeah, choked up.
Well, you can hear that he knew about the media vendetta against Lemieux.
Yep.
I think every young kid that grows up in Montreal wants to carry that cup around, and that was certainly a dream of mine.
Players held the precious silver chalice aloft as childhood dreams of a Stanley Cup championship.
This guy was like a poet. Mario.
So many of us have labored so long.
Name one time you heard the word aloft, like in the last 10 years.
Experience that again together. You dream about this from the time you're a little kid, and you want to be in the Stanley Cup final, you want to win the Stanley Cup final, you want to be able to carry
it. I think we should do a deep dive into that Ron Francis trade. Pinch me or anything.
I mean,
we talked about
Eddie
that.
Johnson.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's.
He made that.
Doesn't make any
no,
sense.
No, at all. He made that big trade, and then Eddie Johnson was like, yeah, I'm going to go to Pittsburgh.
I'm going to ruin the Whalers. Like,
like, it might be why they left Hartford, too. Kim Neely's like.
In the Penguins' emotional locker room, the celebration ranged from shouts of delight to tears of joy.
Well, I hope they're partying in the streets because the people of Pittsburgh.
I love this party. Awesome.
Great fans from everybody, and you know they were stuck by this team and through tough times and good times, so they deserve it most of all.
Great, tagline that is great. Lovely. You can tell there's a couple people that don't want to be there.
Oh, they're drunk. They're probably going to fight with their like girlfriend.
I was there. Like nowadays, like people, there's like no self. You know what I mean? Like this is. I love that scene right there.
The small towns throughout Western Pennsylvania.
So dangerous.
40,000 fans converged on Pittsburgh's international.
Someone died at the airport.
Right? Yeah, I remember. Fucking US Air. They made Lemieux wear a US Air hat.
I never noticed that. I was wondering what hat he wore. Oh, you're right. Oh, that's terrible. They probably paid him like 10 grand. Like such a federal, like the FAA right now.
That's wild how only one person died. There's no...
Yeah, it looks completely unsafe. Yeah. That championship
smile Mountie? In Pittsburgh.
What a scene. What a scene this had to be. Was quite literally an unbelievable outpouring of affection. They went on like a school bus.
Yeah. Yeah.
These are professional athletes. They're on a school bus. Can you imagine now?
Wow.
The celebration spilled over into Tuesday, and the official city tribute to the team at the point in downtown Pittsburgh.
I still can't believe they were, yeah. Moon District School. Oh, wow.
We would have made that a GIF, I think.
We still can.
Yeah, might. Maybe the thumbnail of this video, actually. The man who is most responsible for bringing the cup to Pittsburgh. Who's this guy? Mr. Edward DeBartolo. Civic Arena Corporation.
This is possibly the most exciting moment of my life, and I want to thank you all for your great support.
Is there anything, like, you really don't get much out of these type of, like...
No.
It's just awkward. Remember, like, I kind of checked out on, like, Stanley Cup parades when... Didn't, like, Paul Steigerwald do, like, a raise the roof thing? Like, yeah. I checked out. Thank you, Mr. DeBartolo. This is beautiful.
This is what it's all about. No, but you're exactly right. I kind of check out, too. Like, I don't really... I watch the highlights and stuff, but I'm not...
Yeah, I don't need to go to the parade and that. It's just like it's really awkward. I feel like I'm gonna come up and watch people hold up a cup and give awkward speeches.
Still a great scene, like everyone hanging out of the parking garages and stuff.
Yeah, those are some of the coolest pictures.
That's a young person's game. Like I can't do that.
No, I can't either. So I gotta avoid crowd.
Yeah, I avoid crowds. I don't want to get sunburned. There's too much.
What kind of camera? What kind of camera does?
Yeah.
I wonder if he still has these pictures. I'm going to ask him.
Let's find Larry Murphy. What do you say we take this out of the river and party all summer? And then didn't they throw it into the Lemieux pool?
Yeah. I wonder if somebody still has that. The 1990-91 Stanley Cup champion Pittsburgh Penguins gave us all the season. This would have been the first like world championship in Pittsburgh since like what 1979.
79, yeah. Pirates and Steelers.
We love you guys, yeah. And this cup is for you. Thank you. This cup is for you. Didn't have the glasses on. Weird.
10 years, you can see just like an orgasmic explosion, you know?
Right.
And
this is a
special moment, I'm sure, for the city of Pittsburgh, as it is for... How long has it been? What, 2017? 5 years?
Yeah. Yeah. That might have been the longest...
Earl Man.
Oh, wait, there's the... Earl Man, that's right. I remember you did look that up. Well, that... Yeah, so that would have been... Would that have been, like, the longest period in... Other than, like, the 60s, which no one's alive... you know, whatever. But there would have been like a championship drought.
That's what I'm trying to think.
Like when did Mazeroski hit his home
60.
Run?
60.
So then the Steelers didn't win until
74.
74, so that's 14 years.
But Pirates won in 71.
Oh, that's right. So 11 years. And then they went, and then like the 70s were like, you know, unlimited
drugs
success. And then then 80s, nothing. Like, literally no chance. Like, a whole decade goes by without any champion.
Oh, with nothing. With Mark Malone and Todd Blackledge.
Yeah.
But yeah, mid-80s, Lemieux.
Yeah, that was, I mean, there was, but that was like, it was nothing but.
So.
It's pretty unbelievable.
So wait a minute. Then 92 to 2005 Seahawks was 13 years.
Right.
Which is the biggest championship drought in Pittsburgh, in modern Pittsburgh sports.
Oh, yeah, that was. I guess you're right, huh?
13 years.
13 years, yeah.
And then Penguins and Steelers both won in 2009.
Yeah, so, yeah, you're right. I never thought about that. Like, the 90s started off great, too. Like,
yeah, it didn't turn out. Didn't turn out too well.
We might have to watch. We might have to watch Super Bowl 30.
I think so, too. We're going to draw the ire of, we might just do this all summer, just watch all these games.
I think it's cathartic for some reason. I don't know why.
All right, that's going to wrap this up, though. Happy 1991 anniversary, and come up next week we'll have the 1992 anniversary, and we'll talk about a lost gem in Penguin history, the 2008 Stanley Cup Finals, Peter Sikora Game 5. We might watch just abbreviated highlights or of something or that, and maybe go through some of the old blog posts from that, so that'll be fun, but that'll be next week. But that's it. Hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching.